Hello, I'm John McKay, and I'm the Member of Parliament for Scarborough Guildwood. And my guest today is John MacKenzie, who is the CEO of the TRCA, Toronto Region Conservation Authority, and director of the Toronto Region Conservation Authority as well. John is possibly one of the most influential people in Scarborough Guildwood, who is not really known. So today my task is to probe the real John MacKenzie so that we can see who he is and what's his background, and ask him some questions about what plans he has for this particular region of Scarborough. So John, welcome.
Well, thank you very much, John, and that's a very kind, and I never realized I was so influential in my old neighborhood, but this is wonderful, and I'm really thank you so much for all of your many years of public service, and I've literally grown up in Scarborough and seen you and your team deliver great things for our community, and it's a wonderful privilege to be here with you today. And thank you very much for having me here. I'm thrilled to be here and to talk about the future in Scarborough and what we're trying to do along our shorelines and along our river valleys and the areas that TRCA is involved with in the community. So it's a real pleasure, really excited about this, and I'm in your hands.
So, John, you've already rocketed to the top of the charts because you were raised in Scarborough. So where in Scarborough were you raised?
So I grew up actually on Ellington Drive until we moved out to the east end of Scarborough. So Ellington Drive's at Warden Lawrence. So I went mm-hmm. to Wexford Collegiate for grade 9 and 10, and then the family moved over to, I guess, the bottom of Highland Creek, south of Lawrence there, and they're still there. My mom and dad are still there today at east of Meadowvale in the Centennial community, and that was part of your riding, your earlier
yeah.
riding.
The way at one point, called. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that, and so we were, I was out there, and I ended up graduating from Mowat, and I know folks from Laurier and Mowat shouldn't speak, but I think yeah. it's... Okay.
Well, we'll make an exception this time. You know, okay. Obviously, Laurier has far superior educational accomplishments than does Mowat. Well, we won't go there. Mind you, the hockey team, as I recollect, was pretty good at Mowat. So,
yeah, we had a good rugby team back in the day as well. And yeah. So that's I'm a human tripod, so I focus more on the rugby part of it.
Tripod? So does that mean you're built, John?
Well, when I'm skating, you'll know what I mean. But yeah. But I think it's really amazing to be involved in and working on things in Scarborough again. And so growing up in Scarborough, I obviously was always interested in and spent a lot of time in the Rouge Valley and along the waterfront. And growing up as a kid, you know, my parents would take me down to the Bluffs, or we'd be spending time down by Rouge Beach. I would fish down in the marsh. I would, I'd spend time in the valleys, always at Toronto Zoo. And so being able to work and to make an impact and you know, just to be out in Morningside Creek and to see new bridges and new trails being constructed, and in the places that I grew up running cross country events or running and being involved in the community, it's just such a thrill to be part of making the place that you grew up in an even better place.
Well, the place I grew up in, John, was a few years before the time that you grew up in it. Speaking of cross country trails, the one cross country trail that I do remember is at West Hill Collegiate, and this was before the bridge was built. There was a Bailey Bridge in the valley, and so running down the hill across the Bailey Bridge around Morningside Park was relatively easy. It was running across the Bailey Bridge and up the hill was not so easy, and I for many, many times, despaired of ever making to the top of that hill. But my modest athletic accomplishments, and I'm sure your extraordinary athletic accomplishments, are not the subject of this particular podcast. So after Moat, you went to what school?
I ended up at Brock University, and I was always interested in planning from an early age. I ended up doing urban environmental studies and working and taking geography as well, and physical geography and biology related courses. And so I loved it. I excelled in that. I just really had a passion for the environment. I spent my summers working, volunteering back in the community. A lot of work with Save the Rouge Valley System. I think that's where I initially came across and worked with you and your colleagues at the time on different things. And that was a great experience. But I think, you know, it really, really, really got me excited about this. I ended up working overseas for a bit and doing some projects abroad. I was went to South Korea, where I'd done a year program. I worked in UNESCO, in the Korean National Commission for UNESCO, on environmentally related projects. And then ended up coming back and finishing my graduate studies at University of Toronto, where I was in the the programming planning out of the geography program there. So I ended up at U of T downtown, and you know, straight from there into the provincial government, where I worked for over a decade with the province, and then I ended up in the municipal sector. And now I ended up 3 years ago almost back with the Toronto Region Conservation Authority as their CEO. So it's just been a wonderful, wonderful.
Well, that's either a description of a great career, or you just can't keep a job. One or the other.
I will thankfully, I've continued to move at my own pace, at my own.
as long as all those moves are voluntary, that's a good thing. Yeah. So I did want to talk about your job as CEO of the TRCA. Describe for a lot of people who'd be listening to this, wouldn't have a clue what the Toronto Region Conservation Authority is, but it is a very, very influential organization in all of the GTA, and so tell me A, what its responsibilities are, but B, its geographic footprint.
Great, thank you. And we do have quite a geographic footprint. So just to speak to our responsibilities, we are primarily responsible for protecting health and safety and stewardship of the natural environment. The organization was originally conceived as part of conservation authorities across Ontario, were really brought about as a result of concern about deforestation and stewardship of our water resources and our natural resources. But then Hurricane Hazel came, and that was a devastating flood. And that devastating flood in 1953, that flood was a catalyst for stricter regulations to prevent loss of life, to protect property, and that resulted in conservation authorities becoming even more, more enshrined in legislation with regulatory powers. And the Toronto Region Conservation Authority in particular became a consolidated organization that includes now 9 different watersheds across the Greater Toronto Area. We have about 5 million people living in our jurisdiction, and our jurisdiction extends from Mississauga in the south on the shoreline of Lake Ontario all the way over to the border of Ajax and Whitby. So that would be the bottom of Etobicoke Creek all the way over to Carruthers Creek on the Lake Ontario shoreline. So that's 65 kilometers approximately of Lake Ontario shoreline, in addition to Toronto Island and a number of the other coastal areas that we are a regulatory authority on. So we make sure that projects and that permissions are reviewed related to proposals on the waterfront, and we try to protect property and lives from risks of erosion, high waves. Now extreme weather events are becoming more frequent as a result of climate change, and so we have a really important role in making sure that the cities and the coastline of the Greater Toronto Area is protected from high water events. We've been very involved in the response of trying to manage high water events that have become more frequent and record-breaking in 2019. And the work that we undertook in 2017 helped avoid more impacts in 2019. But these events and extreme weather events are becoming more frequent. We also play a similar role in maintaining and protecting infrastructure, lives, and property within the valley systems. And our jurisdiction extends all the way up to the headwaters of the Humber River in the north, which is north of Highway 9, almost all the way to Orangeville on the west side. And then we also extend to the top of Duffins Creek, all the way up into Uxbridge. So we have a very large geographic area across the Greater Toronto Area that we play a regulatory role on. And we also undertake stewardship projects that include everything from forestry projects where we go in and manage and restore wetlands. We make sure that the emerald ash borer trees, when they're infected, do not fall and create hazards. We do a lot of diverse types of work. We do education programs, and many people have experienced TRCA by visiting Black Creek Pioneer Village. People have visited that site, and we also have that attraction. We have a number of conservation areas that people visit, everything from Petticoat Creek, that's not too far away from your riding, all the way to Tommy Thompson Park, which is a very a well-used green space in the middle of the city of Toronto, which is an oasis and an internationally recognized bird area, all the way to Albion Hills Conservation Area in Caledon, Heart Lake, Bruce's Mill, some of those sites, and the Oak Ridge Corridor area that we manage with the province. So there's a number of conservation areas across our jurisdiction that we also manage.
Yeah. The interestingly, a side note here on the Thompson Park, we're personal friends with a woman who is the great-granddaughter of the original settlers here, the Thompsons, and they actually live quite proximate to the park itself and are real enthusiastic environmentalists. But let me bring you into Scarborough-Guildwood area, which, as everyone knows, is the center of the universe. Mm-hmm. Talk about the watersheds that are in the Scarborough-Guildwood, because we are very fortunate and very blessed to have a number of them. Talk a bit about the Highland Creek, which is which does run really from the Scarborough Town Center right down to the mouth of the creek. It is a degraded watershed, and yet your work is moving towards upgrading, if you will, some of the work. So tell us a bit about what work you have been doing and plan to do in the Highland Creek, and when are you going to get those construction guys out so I can go running back on the trail there at the mouth of the creek?
Well, we heard about someone running through our construction site. That might have been you, but we might let that go. We are actually working very hard and on Highland Creek. It is a real focus for TRCA. It is, like you said, an urbanized watershed. So it's a little flashy. And when I say flashy, when the rain comes down, there's a lot of hard surfaces in Scarborough. And so when the large scale development occurred in the 60s and 70s, there weren't as many controls in place to hold the water before it was released into the rivers like there are today. We require more of that water to be detained and to enter more slowly into our watercourses, but that wasn't the case during that period of time. There's a lot of channelized ditches in Scarborough. I grew up next to a concrete channelized channel that was part of the Don River, Taylor Creek, Taylor Massey Creek over near Warden, and a lot of pipes, a lot of concrete channels that are in the upper reaches of Highland Creek. So that really speeds up the water. And so it creates a lot of erosion issues. And that becomes very evident and noticeable, especially around sites like in Morningside Park or in that area where the trail is running close to the river. And when we get major events, you can actually see the river move over and knock out part of the trail. And then mm-hmm. call me and they'll call you and they'll call the counselors about we need to fix and protect this part of the trail. So there's a lot of work around Highland Creek, and there's a greening strategy that TRCA is advancing with the City of Toronto and with the support of our partners to, and in many cases, this involves the federal government because they've been a great partner to TRCA. And I'll talk a little bit about that related to Rouge National Urban Park later and the work that we're doing on the waterfront. But I think what the important thing is that we have a strategy for greening up Highland Creek, which involves plantings, reforestation of areas where we think there's an opportunity to plant more trees, to install low impact development techniques. So low impact development measures that could involve things like bioswales around parking lots where we can trap and slow down the water running out into our river systems. We have plans to right now around the Markham and Corporate Drive area, Markham Road and Corporate Drive area, we have a whole plan to address some of the flood risk, but that also looks at opportunities to enhance the stream corridor through plantings, and that brings about additional wildlife. We already have a great salmon run, and I know you've been there many, many times at our salmon festival and been involved in that, and so that we have an incredible, and people can't even believe it when they go down to Highland Creek. There's salmon running up the creek. They'll see rainbow trout. It's really, really incredible. And at the bottom parts of the creek, you know, you can, maybe I shouldn't tell people this, and you can fish for bass, you can do all these different things down there, but it's really an incredible resource at Stevenson Swamp. We have a provincially significant wetland and all kinds of biodiversity.
Is that what that's called? I didn't realize. I've never heard it called Stevenson Swamp before, because it is quite a remarkable biodiverse area. Yeah,
it is. And it's tucked in there at the bottom of Highland Creek, but it's connected to the waterfront. And that waterfront connects to the Rouge National Urban Park. And then that connects to the Oak Ridges Moraine. And that connects further on eastward. And I just think it's an amazing, amazing jewel within your riding, the bottom of Highland Creek, but also to the green space networks that we're working on. We have a regional trail strategy that's a lot of attention recently, and we're trying to make more of those connections between Morningside Park and the Meadoway project that I do want to talk about at some point here, because that's a fantastic project that we're
Before we leave Highland Creek, there are times that I've wondered why we harden some surfaces, that some surfaces like parking lots could just as easily be permeable surfaces, and similarly with sidewalks and things of that nature. You sometimes wonder why there are so many sidewalks, in a low pedestrian area when you could leave it to grass and things of that nature. But that's because the problem for you is that you're dealing with the water that's coming into the watershed. You're not dealing with the water that is coming outside from the watershed. So, I'm very pleased to hear about that. The only other comment I'd have is that it is very discouraging to be walking or running in the Highland Creek area and see the litter left behind by some people. It drives me to some point of distraction. So, but that's not generally within your purview.
So, no, but it is something that is of concern, and we are working a little bit, and it's a minor part of our work, but we work in partnership with others to try to reduce plastics. And we have a program with industry right now, and it's called Partners in Project Green, and we work with a number of companies, including a number in Scarborough, a number within Highland Creek, the Highland Creek watershed, and we're working to try to get at the root of some of this and try to reduce these inputs and again, industrial waste and recycling, and trying to reduce inputs at an industrial scale. And so that's an interesting part of TRCA that I learned about, is that there's also a number of programs out there to work with communities and to work with the business community to try to address some of these larger
issues. Is there an organization like Friends of the Highland Creek or things of that nature?
So there was a Friends of the Highland Creek, and there are still members of that Friends of the Highland Creek that we do draw upon from time to time. I remember Karen Boniface was very involved, and others 20 plus years ago. There are members of the community that are part of that. TRCA has a regional watershed alliance that has a youth council that is very involved in doing stewardship activities and are interested in doing more work around Highland Creek.
Well, I sometimes think that, you know, one of the best ways to take stewardship seriously is if the local folks join up and take responsibility for at least the cleanliness and then, you know, talking to folks like yourselves on what they consider to be the priority projects. But Highland Creek is only one of the watersheds. So talk to me a bit about the waterfront, which has been transformed by the TRCA. I can remember back in 97 when I first became a member of parliament, my first meeting was with the councillor and the provincial representative of the time, and they wanted money from the federal government for the waterfront, and it took a number of years, but we actually got to it. I was staggered by the number of authorities relating to any development along the waterfront, including the military, who have to be apparently worried about invasions from buffalo and things like that before we can move on things. So I imagine at one point that was a serious concern. I don't know that it's such a serious concern. We'll see what next week's election brings, though. So tell me what's going on with the waterfront.
Incredible things, and I guess I want to thank you for being part of those discussions, because during that time I was involved with some members of the community, and one gentleman, Bill Dempsey, I remember him inspiring me. Actually, he was one of my mentors when I was a younger planner, a very strong community leader, and I remember him showing up and helping me get him to get down to Metro Council meetings so he can bang on a table and say,
you can never say no to Bill, never.
and so there was a lot of great community interest and effort that went into getting the waterfront in a better position. And I think one of the things that we've tried to do at TRCA is to enable that through technical science, scientific expertise, and knowledge of how to build infrastructure within these, sensitive environments, and so that, as you mentioned, there is a whole myriad of complex approvals, from Environmental Assessment Act approvals, Department of Fishery and Oceans, MNRF approvals. The list goes on and on and on. So one of the things we do at TRCA is conduct a lot of technical studies. We have the expertise to conduct those environmental assessments, to obtain the buy-in from those agencies and support, and to obtain those approvals to advance those projects. And so we've been doing that with our partners at the City of Toronto. Our partners at City of Toronto have been fantastic in supporting our efforts on that, but also the federal government and has been really, especially now with Rouge National Urban Park coming on, we're cooperating. And even today, multiple times this morning, I was in discussions with Parks Canada staff, and we're working to try to advance plans to have a more resilient and, I guess, more accessible waterfront for citizens of Scarborough. And that would include additional works to try to tie in Rouge National Urban Park with our waterfront.
Well, you know, John, that this is such a prestigious program that we've already had Dolph Young on to talk about the Rouge National, about the zoo, and then we had Omar McDavy on to talk about the park itself. This is the Holy Trinity. You're completing the number three in the entire process here. So cheap and cheerful. What's the what is going on by the sewage plant over west of Morningside? What's the latest on that?
Great. So I'm glad you asked. So what we've done is we've conducted a multi-year environmental assessment to approve a waterfront trail along the and part of it's along the base of the bluff-like areas there, and part of it we move up into East Point Park, and that's right. The plan currently. So we maintain some of the historic natural beaches at the bottom of the shoreline. And that's our plan right now, is to connect the waterfront. And this is something that David Crombie and many, many people have, in the regeneration plans and the Royal Commission for Toronto's Waterfront, they've talked about it for 35 plus 40 years, trying to connect Toronto, Lake Ontario through this waterfront trail. And so we're advancing that vision, and we've got an environmental assessment approved from Brimley Road and the bluffs there all the way out to East Point Park, when then it would connect to the rest of the trail that goes along the base all the way to Rouge National Urban Park. So we've got a plan in place. We're advancing that with a priority focus around Brimley right now. We've got some detailed design work going on around Brimley, and from that area east of Brimley, we have some new beaches planned and some, I guess, structures called groins that extend out into the water and provide habitat, but also really reduce the energy of the waves and allow for the beaches to stabilize, so that way it doesn't impact and result in more portions of the bluffs falling over and creating dust clouds that can be a big hit on social media. I think we saw that this summer. So we're really trying to continue momentum on that project. And I think, you know, we've been working hard to apprise all levels of government of the interest in investing in this area, especially with COVID, especially with the demand for green space. We see this incredible opportunity to connect the waterfront in this area. It will be a net benefit for habitat within the water for the aquatic habitat, but it will also be an opportunity to improve those terrestrial connections in the area. And it's just going to be a great amenity for
local. It is amazing. You go there on a Sunday afternoon, particularly out towards Port Union. It's the beaches. It's the boardwalk of East Scarborough. And if you can extend it off to Brimley and make it accessible, that will be just an amazing asset to this this larger community. So the other one that keeps coming up, obviously, is the Rouge Park, the urban largest urban park in the world, I believe. And as you know, that was quite a fight for a long period of time. So things do seem to be moving forward there. And Omar was excitedly talking about the entrance to the park and the trails that are planned and et cetera, et cetera. So how do you and Omar and Dolph all interact as if you will, the chief operating officers of three very, very significant organizations out here?
Well, I'll give you an example. I've spoken to all these folks at least two or three times this week. and it seems to be that kind of, at least that
you're on direct dial then, are you?
Yeah, we're on direct dial, and we trade notes on almost at least a weekly basis, but almost a daily basis. I participated in Minister Wilkinson's roundtable, and the CEO of Parks Canada, they had a roundtable over the last couple of weeks and on the urban parks agenda. And I was specifically brought in to speak about the Rouge National Urban Park experience and what we are doing as a partner in terms of delivering trails. We are managing and, as you know, the Glen Rouge campground, and working with Parks Canada on updating and retrofitting that campground to modernize it, to make it more user-friendly, and to really make this an even more incredible place for people to visit and to experience nature in the heart of the fastest growing region, in one of the fastest growing regions in North America. So we are working all the time, constantly. We jointly submit proposals together on projects. So if they're working on updating things in the zoo, we'll come in and be in a technical advisor. We are working on submitting projects together for other governments to take a look at and to potentially fund right now. And really, it's a close partnership. We formalized that through memorandums of understanding signed between TRCA, the zoo, and Parks Canada, Rouge National Urban Park, and we continue to work in partnership. And I think it's just going to grow stronger and stronger. And I think that's the new model of partnership. I think it's one thing when you're out there in the middle of, my daughter had to do a project on Cape Breton National Park. And that's one thing when you're way out there or you're way up in Wood Buffalo, and there's partnerships required in those areas too. But when you have so many municipalities and so many agencies and so many different partners, I think it's a new model of partnership going forward that we'll see with Parks Canada. So it's great to be part of this. I've only been involved in the effort to protect the Rouge since the late 80s when Save the Rouge had, I had a summer course in Winston Churchill, and Save the Rouge Valley System had their offices there. And so, you know, some of these Save the Rouge folks that were there, and, you know, the lowest.
Oh, I know. They're
all those folks.
Well, it is an interesting testimony to citizen involvement. If it was not for, you know, Friends of the Rouge, Save the Rouge, and, you know, you would know the myriad of groups that would have been paved over. You know, that it would have been developed, and we would have a whole whack of subdivisions out there. But people had a vision, and they were persistent, and they harassed people like me and Derek Lee and Steve Gilchrist and a whole bunch of people that finally set it aside. So it actually is kind of an interesting testimony, but it is kind of it also is a segue into I know a new project that's near and dear to your heart, and it all kind of comes together at where the zoo and the Rouge Park all come together with this Metaway project. So if we could get it thrown up on the screen, you can kind of describe it to the people who will be watching this, and tell us what your vision is there and where it is and what we're looking at.
Well, this is great. So I guess this is one of the most incredible, I guess, when you talk about Scarborough leading the world, innovation. This is an incredible project that is coming out of Scarborough, but it is being looked at by organizations all over North America, for starters, but in other parts of the world as well. So we have a series of transmission corridors, and this main one that we talked about, Thompson Park and Scarborough earlier, but the hydro corridor that runs across from Victoria Park and goes all the way to Rouge Park, but then goes eastwards, is called the Gatineau Transmission Corridor. And so what we've been working on, and it started with Glenda Bearmaker and a number of citizens trying to get a Scarborough Butterfly Meadow, that was such a huge success that the concept grew into this Meadowway concept that we're now advancing. And with the support of the Garfield W. Weston Foundation and the City of Toronto, we've been able to start a whole program to look at changing the habitats and that corridor that was mown. And you can see it's just a grass corridor. If you move forward a few slides, you can actually see that what we're trying to do is improve this by plantings. And you can see some of the restoration where we have wildflowers and meadows and the community involved in this area to have an active transportation route, a cycling route and walking trails. And then we have a restored meadow habitats that will take you all the way across Scarborough. And it's an incredible opportunity for environmental education, engaging students in all of the different schools that are located across the corridor. And so we've been lucky enough to get some support from the Garfield W. Weston Foundation. They came forward and put a $10 million investment on the table. And what we're working to try to do now is to lever that investment by the Weston Foundation to try to get other levels of government and to try to work with the City of Toronto to allocate any funds that they have available into this incredible opportunity. So right now, you'll see our people out in the field doing the restoration work. They till the fields. They basically put the, they, I guess, fix the nitrogen. They ready it for planting. And then we have school groups coming in. We have all these community workshops. We've been able to advance this. And right now, because of COVID, we haven't had as many community events as we'd like to, just because of the field procedures that we have to follow. But our staff have been readying these fields. We've been planting away during this whole period of time, and we'll continue to do so. So I think in the future, and you know, as we go through this, there's a lot to see, and I want to make sure that we'll have a link to some of this information afterwards. But What we are also doing is to install some new infrastructure, including bridges that will connect the Highland Creek Trail that we talked to before. And you can see some of these connections on the screen here. But the key thing is that we're gonna have a link from Rouge National Urban Park all the way across Scarborough into the Don River. So into the heart of the city of Toronto, people can get there safely by bicycle. That's the vision. And one of the things that I mentioned before about being a leader on this, there's approximately 40,000 kilometers of hydro corridors, 40,000 acres of hydro corridors in Southern Ontario alone. And so by us doing this here and showing proof of concept, this will be something that we can export to other parts of Ontario and then beyond to other parts of North America. So when I visit other cities, I see this metaway, I see these metaway opportunities. You know, I'll visit Edmonton, Alberta with the, and then I'll see these hydro corridors that are just being mowed. And I'm like, wow, we could bring the metaway here, we could bring the metaway there. So there's all these opportunities for doing this. So TRCA has been really leading this project. That's Ellesmere. That graphic shows the bridge at Ellesmere that we're installing. And we're—
So that's being installed as we speak?
Yes. Yeah. There's bridges. Well, there's a design on this one. There's some other big bridges that you've seen that I think you wanted to jog through just to the south of there as well that are under construction right now. But there's some additional bridges that we're going to be installing in 2021. We're working towards installing those. And if we can do it sooner, we will.
Yeah, well, that, just to get, give people a context, that's, I believe that is just west of the hospital,
right,
down in the valley on the south side.
That's right.
Yeah. And that is a bit of a challenge to kind of get across that that valley from one side of the corridor to the other. And so it's good to see the progress is being made there. And that, then, that too leads up into Centennial College. You just keep following the Highland Creek up there and it goes right by the property of the college.
So, yeah, it's an excellent opportunity to connect the University of Toronto, who have come on and are now a strong partner in the Meadowway project as well. They've provided some space where we can expand and build the trail, and we've connected the trail up into their campus, and they've got students that are doing research about the pre and post, showing the net positive effects of the work to improve the hydrology of the area, and in terms of retaining the planted with the native plants and with the wildflowers, it retains and slows down the water that we talked about going into Highland Creek at an expanded rate. So it actually slows down the runoff, and we are addressing that erosion issue in a way through the Meadowway as well through this project. So one of the things about this, it is also beautifying this part of the city, turning something that was, I guess, you know, in some cases, just a mown, sterile environment into a vibrant place. And it's really making the best use out of our green space at this time.
It really is a community enhancement. But, you know, as I say, John, when you go to Edmonton, if you want something done right, you get some guy from Scarborough to do it, right?
Yeah. Is that what they said when you were there on standing committee? Okay.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you ask them, of course, I had to tell them, but, you know, after a while, they kind of get it.
I was thrilled about the Meadowway because it's, again, a project in Scarborough that's now won a National Award of Excellence from the Canadian Society of Landscape Architects. It's really become something that the High Line Network, which is a network, and if you know the High Line in New York City, that High Line Network approached us about becoming part of it because they thought it was a great way of learning about what we were doing with this infrastructure corridor. So that was a privilege of being invited to be part of that.
Is this the one where they put kind of a park on top of what was a disused rail corridor?
That's correct. Yeah. So it was an elevated sub, you know, the subway and the parts of it that come out. They actually have that connecting communities within New York City.
Yeah.
Amazing. So we're really we're working very hard to again lever that initial investment from the Garfield W. Weston Foundation, and we're excited about any opportunities to enhance this system.
Well, I can tell you categorically that this is a unanimously endorsed project by the Scarborough Caucus, all six of us, and the ravine strategy. was endorsed unanimously by the 416 caucus. So it fits within both endorsations, if you will, or endorsements. And hopefully this will translate into some, by some means or another, some tangible support from the federal government. So my colleagues and I are really pushing for some success here. And let's hope we see it sooner rather than later.
Yes, and we had one of your colleagues, Minister McKenna, here a couple of weeks ago. And with Councillor Jennifer McKelvey, we were, again, advocating as a team. And we've got a fantastic team on this. Lisa Turnbull is our face on the project. And her and her team have just really made a great impact on this. And we'll continue to work in partnership. And I think, you know, the discussions, again, this partnership between Dolph and Omar and all of us that we talked about, that's also really good. I'm looking forward to trying to work more closely with Rouge National Park and making that connection with the new visitor center that's being planned and designed. And so that connection to the Meadowway, I know Omar and I are looking to see if we can do something on that, that will really formalize the connection.
Well, it's kind of like blindingly obvious that the Gatineau corridor or the Meadowway has to cross over the park. So somehow or another, there has to be some could you would think relatively easily be some sort of connecting manner. We are unfortunately going to have to leave it there. John, you know, we set out saying that you were one of the most influential people in Scarborough that nobody knows. I hope we've at least reduced the notion that nobody knows about John MacKenzie anymore, so that when they see you out there doing your thing, they'll say, "Oh, I remember you. You were on that podcast." So I thank you, John, for your work in with the TRCA, but also your personal passion. You know, you can't do what you do without just being absolutely committed and seeing the great opportunities that are available out here, and particularly out here in Scarborough, but really across the GTA. So thank you for your work, and thank you for coming on. And hopefully this will generate some enthusiasm and a bit more volunteerism, and we can address some of the issues that you are facing on a daily basis. So again, thank you.
Oh, thank you, John. And it's really thinking globally, acting locally. I know it's such an old phrase, but I think it's so important to make those differences in your community. And you've made a huge difference. I always appreciate all of the time that you've taken to listen over the many, many times that I've approached your office over the years and help us advance our shared objectives. And I really appreciate all of that. And thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today.
It's always a good time to talk. Thanks, John.